Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Media presents The Pathway of Roses, written by Christian D. Larson, narrated by Grover Gardner. To live always in the secret places of the Most High, to think only those thoughts that are inspired from above, to do all things in the conviction that God is with us, to give the best to all the world with no thought of reward, to leave all recompense to him who doeth all things well, to love everybody as God loves us and be kind as he is kind, to ask God for everything and in faith expect everything, to live in perpetual gratitude to him who gives everything, to love God so much that we can inwardly feel that my Father and I are one. This is the prayer without ceasing, the true worship of the soul. Chapter 1. Paths to the Life Beautiful. The thinking world of today is being filled with a phase of thought that has exceptional value. True, some of it is in a somewhat chaotic condition, but most of it is rich, containing within itself the very life of that truth that is making the world free. But in the finding of this truth, and in the application of its principles, where are we to begin? What are we to do first? And after we have begun and find ourselves in the midst of a life so large, so immense, and so marvelous that it will require eternity to live it all, what are the great essentials that we should ever remember and apply? What are the great centers of life about which we may build a greater and greater life? These are questions that thousands are asking today, and the answer is simple. First, recognize the great truth that every individual can live his own life exactly as he may desire to live. Man himself is the real master of his own existence, and he himself may determine how perfect and how beautiful that existence is to be. Your life is in your own hands. You may live as you wish. You may secure from life whatever you desire, because there is no limit to life and no limit to your capacity to live. The elements of life can be modified, changed, developed, and perfected to comply with your own supreme demand. The increase of life can be realized in the exact measure of your largest need. You are in living touch with infinite life, and there is neither limit nor end to the source of your supply. To live in the constant recognition of this great truth is to rise continually into higher and higher degrees of that mastery of life that gives man the power to live his life according to his most perfect ideals. To reach the goal that every ascending mind has in view, this truth, therefore, must ever be recognized and applied. It is one of those principles that we shall always require, no matter how high we may rise in the scale of divine being. Second, desire that which you desire, and desire with all the power of mind and soul. We invariably receive what we desire, no more, no less. We get what we wish for if the power within that wish is as strong as we can make it. The fact that we can have an ideal proves that we have the power to secure it. The fact that we can formulate and appreciate a desire for something larger and better proves that we can fulfill that desire. The great essential is to desire with the whole heart, that is, to give our desires all the life and power that we can possibly arouse from the depths of invincible being. The true desire and the true prayer are synonymous. The true prayer is invariably some immensely strong desire expressed when the human mind feels the sublime touch of the infinite mind. And the true desire must be in perfect touch with infinite life in order to be filled with the invincible power of that life. To cause every wish to come true, we must express all the power of mind and soul through every wish. But we cannot give expression to all the power within us until we awaken our spiritual natures. And we cannot awaken our spiritual natures until we begin to live with the infinite. The largeness and immensity of the supreme spiritual life within us comes forth only as consciousness is spiritualized, and we gain spiritual consciousness By living and thinking constantly in the lofty state where we actually feel that God is closer than breathing, nearer than hands and feet. We cannot desire too much, and when we desire with all the life and power that is within us, our desires shall positively be fulfilled. The wish must be wholehearted, not half-hearted. It must contain all the power we have, not simply the limited actions of shallow thinking. And it must contain soul, not simply emotion, but that deep spiritual feeling that touches the very spirit of limitless life and power. Third, have faith in God, have faith in man, have faith in yourself, have faith in everything, and have faith in faith. When you have confidence in yourself, you arouse everything that is stronger, greater, and superior in yourself. In consequence, the more confidence you have in yourself, the more you will attain and accomplish. But the power of self-confidence is but an atom in comparison with the marvelous power of faith. Faith takes mind and soul to the greater realms of life. It goes out upon the boundless and awakens those interior spiritual forces that have the power to do anything. This is why all things become possible when we have faith. It is the nature of faith to break bounds, to transcend limitations, and take life, thought, and action into the universal. It is the nature of faith to unite the lesser with the greater, to unite the mind of man with the mind of God. Therefore, we shall always require faith. However far we may go into the greater, the superior, and the boundless today, faith will take us farther still tomorrow. And that is our purpose, to realize our largest and dearest desires in the present, and then press on to the realization of other and far greater desires in the future. Fourth, depend upon the superior man within for results, and give this greater man the credit for everything you accomplish. When you depend upon the personal self, you place yourself in touch only with the lesser forces on the surface. You therefore will accomplish but little. But when you depend upon the supreme spiritual self, you place yourself in touch with the greater powers within, and the results will be greater in proportion. When you give credit to the personal self, you ignore the interior spiritual man. You thereby fail to secure that greater wisdom and power that the spiritual man alone can supply. Instead of being led by that inner light that knows, you are led by the confusion of outer thought. You are turned away from the path that leads to truth, freedom, and the perfect life, and your mistakes are many. Instead of being taken into the current of that invincible life that can carry you through to your very highest goal, you remain in the hands of mere physical energy, that energy that can do nothing more than simply keep your body alive. Whenever you accomplish something worthwhile and give the praise to your own outer personal self, you immediately lose your hold on those powers through which those results were gained. In consequence, failure will begin, and you will have to retrace all your former steps to again gain possession of that power that can do whatever you may wish to have done. To constantly depend upon the greater self, to constantly expect the desired results from the greater self, and to always give credit to the greater self is to constantly draw upon the limitless wisdom and power of the greater self, the supreme spiritual man within you. You thereby become larger and stronger in all the elements of your being, rising ever in the scale, gaining ground perpetually, and passing from victory to victory. What you desire, you will receive, because higher power is working through you. And as you ascend in the scale, there is nothing that you will not attain and accomplish. The principal cause of failure among those who are trying to live in harmony with real truth may be found in the general tendency to think of the outer person as the power that does things on the visible plane. But it is the interior man that gives the power, though the outer person is required to apply it. And the more thought we give to the interior man, the more life and power we bring forth from within. The interior man is the man created in the image and likeness of God. It is therefore evident that when you begin to live with the life and the power of the interior man, the expression of real greatness and real spirituality will begin. And from that moment, you will not be limited to the power of the personal self. Instead, you will fill the personal self with that divine power from on high that is limitless, inexhaustible, and invincible. Fifth, live for a great purpose, and hold the central idea of that purpose constantly before mind. Do not live for the mere sake of prolonging existence. Live for something that magnifies on the largest possible scale all the elements of existence. To live for a great purpose is to live a great life, and the greater your life, the greater the good that you will receive from life. The ruling desire of every living soul is to have life and have it more abundantly. Therefore, to fulfill that desire, we must continue perpetually to live for that which produces more life. No matter how rich we may become in the real spiritual life, here is a principle that we must ever remember and apply. Do not work for yourself. Work for the great idea that stands at the apex of your greatest purpose. The greater the idea for which you work, the greater will be your work. And it is he who does the greatest work that does the most for everybody, himself included. When your work is great, you become a great power for good among thousands, and at the same time you do more for yourself than you could possibly do in any other manner. When you begin to live and work for a great purpose, you get into the current of great forces, great minds, and great souls. You gain from every source. All the powerful lives in the world will work with you. You become a living part of that movement in the world that determines the greater destiny of man. You become one of the chief elements upon which will depend the future of countless generations yet to be. You become one of the chosen, of the Most High. To live for a great purpose is to live in the world of great ideas, and great ideas awaken great thoughts. Man is as he thinks. Great thoughts produce great minds. From great minds proceed great works, and great works constitute the building material with which the kingdom upon earth is to be constructed. When we begin to live for a great and good purpose, we place in action that law that causes all things to work together for good. Henceforth, nothing is in vain. Every person, thing, or event that comes into our world will add to the welfare, the richness, and the beauty of that world. All things become ministers of the life that is real life. We have been giving our best everywhere, and we are receiving the best from every source in return. To live for that which is high, lofty, and sublime is to walk with God. The love, the life, the power, and the wisdom of the infinite will ever be with us, and to have such companions is to be blessed indeed. Every moment will give us the peace that passeth understanding. Every hour will be filled with the joy everlasting, and every day will be as 1,000 years in celestial kingdoms on high. To give the world emancipation is the ruling desire of all minds that are spiritually awakened. And these should remember that to overcome evil with good is the only way. Forget the wrong that may appear in the outer world of things, and give all your thought to the great good that is inherent in all things. You thereby place in action the greatest emancipating power that the human race will ever know. We are in bondage because we have lived to please the person. Follow the soul, and freedom shall come quickly. Then we shall please the person better than ever before. To follow the soul is to enter the great domains of life, those domains from which we may secure everything that is rich and beautiful and superior in human existence. The soul leads not only into the life more abundant, but also into the actual possession of all the spiritual riches that the greater life may contain. And when we find the kingdom that is within, all that we may desire in the without shall be added. The soul that lives most perfectly in the present creates most nobly for the future. Be yourself today, regardless of what happened yesterday. Be all that you are or can be today, and you will live in a fairer world tomorrow. Chapter 2. The Way to Freedom. There is only one will in the universe, just as there is only one mind. The one mind is the mind of God. The one will is the will of God. The mind of individual man is an individual or differentiated expression of the infinite mind, and the largeness of this human mind depends upon how much of the one mind man may decide to appropriate. Man has the freedom to incorporate in his own individual consciousness as much of the infinite mind as he may desire, and as the mind of the infinite is limitless, the mind of man may continue to become larger and larger without any end. The will of the individual mind is a partial expression of the will of God, just as the force of growth that is in each branch is a part of the same force that is in the vine, and the power of the individual will depends upon how perfectly the individual mind works in harmony with the infinite mind. There is no limit to the power of the will of God, the divine will. Therefore, when the human will is as large a part of the divine will as the individual mind can appropriate and apply, the human will necessarily becomes immensely stronger. And since the individual mind can appropriate a larger and a larger measure of the divine will, there is no limit to the power of will that can be developed in the mind of man. To develop the true will, the first essential is to realize that there is but one will, and that we will with the one will just as we live the one life and think with the one mind, though in our thinking, living, and willing, we do not as a rule do justice to that part of the whole which it is our privilege to use. We think, live, and will too much as isolated entities, instead of as divine beings eternally united with the Supreme. The second essential is to realize that the divine will works only for better things and greater things. The path of the divine will is upward and onward forever, and its power is employed exclusively in building more lofty mansions for the soul. Therefore, the will of God does not produce sickness, adversity, or death. On the contrary, the will of God eternally wills to produce wholeness, harmony, and life. The ills of personal life are not produced by divine will. They are produced by man's inability to properly use that part of divine will that is being expressed in his mind. And his inability comes because man does not always apply his will in harmony with the divine will. When man uses his will as his own isolated power, he separates his mind more and more from the source of his power. In consequence, the power of his will becomes weaker, and he necessarily fails to accomplish what he has in view. He also falls apart from the one ascending current of life. He gets out of harmony with the true order of things, and sickness, trouble, adversity, and want invariably follow. The true use of the human will is to apply the will in the full recognition of the oneness of the human will with the divine will. My will is as much of the divine will as I am using now, and it is my privilege to use as much of the divine will as I may desire. To constantly think of my will and the divine will as the same will is to place my mind in such perfect harmony with limitless power of divine will that I can appropriate this power in larger and larger measure, and the more I appropriate, the stronger becomes the power of will in me. When the individual mind is in such perfect harmony with the Supreme Mind that the divine will can be given free and full expression, the will of the individual mind becomes invincible. The secret, therefore, of developing a powerful will is found here and here alone. The true will is never domineering nor antagonistic, neither does it ever apply the force of resistance. If you are antagonistic or have a tendency to resist everything that is not to your liking, it is proof conclusive that you are not in harmony with divine will. You are misdirecting your power and are forming obstacles and pitfalls for yourself. The divine will does not attempt to overcome evils and obstacles with antagonistic or domineering forces. The divine will does not fight wrong, it transforms wrong. It works in silence and serenity, but goes so deeply into the elements of things that it undermines the very first causes of all adverse or detrimental conditions. It does not resist the surface, but goes calmly beneath the surface and transforms those undercurrents from which surface conditions proceed. The divine will, by going into the deeper life of all things, transforms all things into harmony with itself, and can transform all things because its power is supreme. Therefore, when we are in the midst of adversity, we should not rail against fate nor antagonize those conditions that seem to work against us. We have within us the power of divine will, and this will can change everything for good. But it not only can, it will. It is not the will of God to keep any person in adversity. It is the will of God to set every person free, and every person will be set free when he places his life completely in the hands of divine will. When the individual mind can say from the heart, "Thy will be done," the individual life has been placed in the power of divine will, and that life will at once begin to pass out of adversity, sickness, trouble, and want into the world of freedom. However, we do not give up our individuality when we give our mind over to divine will. We do not become automatons in the hands of some superior power. On the contrary, we open our minds to that power that alone can produce individuality. The individuality we now possess has been formed by whatever measure of divine will that we have incorporated in our own conscious existence, and by opening our minds completely to divine will, we shall gain sufficient power to make our individuality infinitely stronger and superior to what it is now. Our purpose is not to be used by the Supreme, but to use the power of the Supreme. To live the life of God, think the thought of God, and will with the will of God that is the secret path to the highly developed individuality. It is such an individuality that becomes a mastermind, a son of the Most High. When the individual mind declares, "Thy will be done," consciousness must fully recognize the presence of supreme power, and must realize, with depth of thought and feeling, that supreme power invariably leads to higher ground, the world of freedom and superior existence. When the mind gives up to divine will in an indifferent, submissive, self-surrendering attitude, it is not giving up to divine will, it is simply giving up to the surrounding forces of fate. Such a mind will permit the forces of adversity to have their way, thinking that it is the will of God that much suffering must still be endured, and will consequently drift with circumstances, accepting whatever comes as a necessary chastisement. This method, however, weakens the mind and places the individual more out of harmony with God than ever before. We always place ourselves out of harmony with God when we accept evil as coming from Him, and we weaken our own ability to use divine will when we permit adversity to exist, thinking that it was sent from God. To give the mind over to divine will is not to give up at all, in the ordinary sense of that term. We simply place ourselves in that position where we can use the power of the one true will instead of a mere imitation. We blend our own desires and aims with that power that we know can see us through, and we work in the realization that whatever is detrimental in our plans will be eliminated as we press on towards the great goal in view. The mind that is aimless, waiting for the will of God to take him where he belongs, will drift with fate. He is not in the hands of divine will, he is in the hands of circumstances, because he has not given divine will something to do. God does not tell us what to do. He has given us the wisdom to know our own desires and our own tendencies, and He has given us the power to fulfill those desires, but we must take individual action. This is why we have individuality and free individual choice. However, when we do take individual action, God will work with us if we enter into harmony with Him, and when He is with us, failure is impossible. To use divine will, we must first have a lofty purpose in view. We must have something high and something definite that we wish to attain. We must have something upon which to apply the limitless power of divine will, and we must desire to reach that goal with the very deepest and strongest desires of heart and soul. Then we must will to press on, knowing that we are using divine will, the supreme will of the Most High, because this is the only will in the universe. It is the will that eternally wills the higher, the greater, and the better, the will that is invincible and always does what it wills to do. To the minds of the many, the true meaning of the will of God has not been made perfectly clear. Therefore, the majority, even among those who have strong spiritual tendencies, hesitate to give up to the absolute direction of higher power. There is a slight dread in the mind of the average person whenever he thinks of entering the uncertainty and the mysteriousness of the seeming void, and as long as things are reasonably well, he does not care to give up to some power he knows nothing of. And as a true understanding of higher power cannot be found among the many, there are accordingly but few who can actually declare with the whole heart, "Thy will be done." We frequently pray for His will to guide us. Nevertheless, we inwardly expect to use our own wills in mostly everything we do. But such prayers are not true to the Spirit, and therefore they prevent the soul from actually discerning the real meaning of God's will, and also prevent the mind from becoming a perfect channel for the expression of His will. The universe is orderly from center to circumference, and everything is established upon the firm foundation of eternal right and universal good. There is a power that lives and moves throughout this vast immensity, and all those things that have a permanent place in the cosmos, or that are instrumental in any way in promoting the purpose of life, have their source in this one power. All the laws and forces in existence spring originally from this power. It is therefore the center and source of all that lives and moves. And this power is the will of God. Accordingly, to do the will of the Father is to enter into harmony with the universal order and promote the great eternal plan. The laws of life are all expressions of supreme will. God wills eternally the right and the true, and the act of His willing originates and perpetuates the sublime plan of life that harmoniously thrills the entire cosmos during endless eternities. God's will is constant and changeless. Therefore, all the laws and principles in existence remain ever the same, as they are all the expression of the one will. All that we see in the life of the universe is the eternal coming forth of divine will and the perpetual returning to the one source. The true will in every soul is an individualization of infinite will, and the true use of the individual will means the doing of the will of God. The infinite will does not seek to control things, but seeks eternally to give itself to things. And here lies the secret in correctly using the human will and in placing the human will in perfect harmony with God's will. When you can say with the whole heart, "Thy will be done," you are not giving up your own will, but you are placing your own will and the whole of your life in oneness with God and in harmony with the universal order. Therefore, when you do the will of God, your own will becomes right and becomes infinitely stronger than it ever was before. When we act in perfect accord with the laws of life and all the planes of being, we are doing the will of God because what we call law in life is the will of God and expression in life. He who lives in perfect harmony with nature, who fully appreciates her grandeur and her beauty, and who daily seeks to be inspired by the loveliness of her presence, is doing the will of God in the natural world. He who rightly employs all the elements of mind and body, and who furthers the purpose of his own being in constant growth and unfoldment, is doing the will of God in the human world. He who searches the deep things of God and enters into that high state where God becomes closer than breathing, nearer than hands and feet, he who lives and moves and has his being in the infinite sea of divine light and ever ascends higher and higher into the greater glories of God's kingdom, is doing the will of God in the spiritual world. Whoever can say with his whole heart, "Thy will be done," has placed the whole of his life in perfect accord with God, and henceforth he will seek to live in perfect harmony with all that is, because all is of God. To do the will of God is not only to place one's life in the hands of God, but to be at peace with all the world, and to give one's whole life to all the world. The will of God seeks eternally to give itself to things, all things. The will of man, to be in harmony with the will of God, must do the same. However insignificant a law may seem to be, it is God working in that part of His universe. And as he is everywhere, manifesting his power everywhere, we must live and work with him in all things, even the most trivial, if we would be in perfect accord with his life and always do his will. A law in life is a path to greater things. In truth, an open door through which we may pass more closely into his presence. We can meet God at every expression of life, and whenever we are in the highest state of harmony with our expression of life, we have met God in that place. And also, when we use that expression of life in entering into a larger measure of life, we do the will of God in that place. Therefore, whoever meets God everywhere and does his will in every place will realize the fullness of life at all times and under every circumstance. And to realize the fullness of life is to realize the allness of the good. The incompleteness of human life in general is caused by our failure to enter into perfect accord with all the laws in our sphere of existence. We may be wholly right in some things, while the very opposite in other things. We may be scrupulous in regard to the right use of some laws, and at the same time continually negligent in regard to others. There are many who take perfect care of their bodies and comply most rigidly with all known physical laws, yet they violate the laws of mind nearly every hour of their existence. Others are very careful so as to think only the truth and do their best to remain continually in the most beautiful states of mind. But while aiming to live in mental ideals, they are wholly indifferent to the welfare of the body. Not infrequently, we find people who live in perfect accord with intellectual laws but violate daily the moral laws. Also, too many who are the reverse. In brief, the majority do the will of God in some realms while living entirely at variance with his laws in other realms. And here we find the simple answer to many perplexing questions. When some misfortune comes to you that you do not think you deserve, do not think that God is unjust or that fate is unkind. You have simply failed to do his will in all things. Do not blame others, do not blame fate, do not even blame yourself. Simply proceed to readjust your life so that you may become one with him in all things. Then all ills shall disappear, and you shall not only regain what you have lost, but you shall, in addition, receive much more. Live in accord with all the laws of life, physically, mentally, and spiritually. Do all things in the consciousness of God. Do all things to the glory of God, and follow the light of his Spirit in every thought and deed. Then you will always do the will of God. Though you may dwell upon the mountaintops of the Spirit, though you may glory in the splendors of the cosmic realm, though your mind may go out upon the vastness of the limitless and your soul ascend to empyrean heights, still do not for a moment deprive the body of anything that is rich and beautiful in physical existence. The great goal is the spiritual life, and in the spiritual life, all the joys of sense, all the joys of intellect, and all the joys of the highest heavens are divinely blended into one. The physical life is sacred. The earth is the footstool of the Most High. God lives in his heaven, but every atom in the visible universe thrills with the glory of his radiant presence. Chapter 3. The Supreme Point of View. When we are upon the mountaintop of life and look upon things from this lofty point of view, we discover that all is well. Wherever we may turn our vision, we find the same. All is well. We can see all things, and yet all is well with all things. The good alone is in evidence. Everything is in the likeness of God, and we conclude that everything actually is as it was originally created by God. Very good. But when we descend to the valley, we find many things quite different. The problem is whether the scene on the mountaintop was simply a beautiful vision, or the scene in the valley an unpleasant illusion. To the mind in the valley, the life of the valley alone seems real. To the mind on the heights, the beauty and glory of sublime life alone seems real, while the regions below are but the undeveloped beginnings of some better day. To decide which of these two minds is right is not necessary. We cannot know the truth by what seems to be true from a single point of view. It is results that demonstrate, therefore we must find what effect life in the valley has upon the whole of life, and what effect life on the heights has upon the whole of life. To live in the valley alone, ignoring everything that may come from lofty realms, is to live in darkness, trouble, and pain. This we know. To him who secludes himself in the lower regions of existence, nothing seems to be wholly well. There is usually something wrong or defective with everything with which he may come in contact, and life at best has but little to give. How different, however, everything becomes when we begin to live on the heights. We not only find that all is well in these upper regions, but all things become well in the lower realms the moment we begin to live in the upper. We must therefore conclude that all is well when we are well, but that we are not well unless we live on the heights. We also conclude that the vision of the soul is true, that the ideal alone is real, and that man can see all things as they are only when entering sublime existence. And as all is well from the viewpoint of sublime existence, to think the truth, man must always think that all is well. To live in the lower realms is to live in pain. To live in the upper realms is to live in peace, freedom, and joy. Then why should we continue to live in the lower while wholly ignoring the upper? Why should we declare that the lower alone is real, and that the upper is but a pleasant dream? Is pain more real than joy? Is bondage more real than freedom? Death more real than life? True daily experience sometimes seems to contradict the vision of the soul. But if darkness be present now, does that prove that light is always a mere dream? When we are wholly out of harmony, we cannot understand, for the time being, how there can be any harmony. All seems to be discord, but the moment we fully recognize the absoluteness of universal harmony, discord is no more. When all does not seem to be well in daily life, we may not feel that we can truthfully say that all is well, but there is a marked distinction between the outer appearance of discord and the inner reality of harmony, and it is the inner reality that we should live. When discord appears on the surface, the cause may be found in the fact that we have descended from our true place. We have tried to go away from harmony and have thus produced discord. But the moment we return to harmony, the discord disappears and all is well. We must conclude, therefore, that so long as we remain in the reality of harmony, all will be well, because all is always well in the world of harmony. And the world of harmony is the true world, the only true world, the world in which man was created to always live. And we must remember the great truth that, so long as man lives in the world of harmony, there can be no discord anywhere. So long as he lives in the upper regions, nothing can go wrong in the lower regions. The lower states of life are but effects of what man does, and when man is on the heights, he will do only that which is well, because all is always well on the heights. Therefore, since like causes produce like effects, all will be well in the valley so long as man lives on the mountaintop. This being true, every person should always think that all is well and should always live in that sublime life where all is absolutely well. Thus, that which is well will manifest in every part of life, while that which did not seem to be well will pass away. Live in the true, and the whole of life becomes true. Whoever discerns clearly the spiritual essence or divine substance which is the basis or soul of all reality will manifest in the form not only purity, but absolute immunity from all disease and from all adverse actions among physical elements and forces. His body will be spiritualized in proportion to this understanding, and will establish itself more and more firmly in that state of being where divine nature reigns supremely. To spiritualize the body is to give greater strength, more perfect health, and more youthful vigor, as well as higher quality to the body. To establish the body in the consciousness of the spirit is to give the body absolute protection from weakness or disease. In the spirit we find all the elements of perfect being for body, mind, and soul, and we place the body in the spirit when we realize that every atom in the body is filled through and through with the real substance of spirit. Make yourself a living example of the power of spirit. Do not permit a single weakness to continue for a moment. Do not say that you will be in the future. Say that you are now. and you are because you are the exact image of the Supreme. Chapter 4. The True Order of Things. What the individual life is to be as a whole or in any of its parts depends upon where the consciousness of being is established, and there are three distinct planes in which this consciousness may be established, viz., the physical, the psychical, and the spiritual. To establish life in the physical is to become a materialist. There will be no consciousness of the finer things of existence, and the understanding of things in general will be one-sided. In consequence, the mind cannot see anything as it really is, and will make mistakes at every turn. The materialist lives for the body alone and depends upon the physical senses exclusively, both for knowledge and enjoyment. But the physical senses are never wholly reliable unless when employed by mental faculties that are above the physical. Therefore, the knowledge of the materialist is composed principally of illusions and half-truths, and his enjoyment is but an inferior imitation of real happiness. The life of the materialist is necessarily full of troubles and ills because he cannot be in harmony with the true principle of life, so long as he is living on the surface of life, instead of in real life itself. In brief, all the ills of life can be traced to materialism in one or more of its various forms. Therefore, the materialist is simply one who denies the existence of the soul. The materialist is anyone who lives in the body, who has established his life in physical existence, and who employs objective senses and faculties only, regardless of what he may believe about God, the soul, or the future. Though a person may be thoroughly religious, as far as he knows, and may believe everything that sacred literature may say about things spiritual, if he cannot comprehend the spiritual except as it is expressed in physical acts, physical ideas, physical rites, or physical symbols, he is still a materialist. He is living in the world of tangible things and has no consciousness of that higher power that produces things. To be spiritual, he must discern the spirit that is within things, back of things, above things. While his senses admire the outer symbol, his spiritual discernment must understand the interior significance of that symbol. Otherwise, he has not found real religion or real spirituality. The mind that has not entered into real spirituality is living in materiality, and to live in materiality is to be in bondage to the ills of this world. Therefore, true existence cannot be realized so long as life is established in the physical plane. To establish life in the psychical plane is to be guided almost entirely by feeling and emotion. But no feeling is absolutely true unless it originates in the soul. And our feelings cannot originate in the soul unless we have established life in the spiritual plane. Therefore, the person who is living in the psychical plane is living in a world of feelings, emotions, desires, and sensations that are more or less abnormal. His mental world is artificial, composed principally of imaginations that are patterned after things from without instead of the understanding of absolute truth from within. The imagination is always influenced a great deal by the play of the emotions. And when the emotions are the results of external suggestions, as they always are unless when we live in the spirit, the imagination will likewise be under the control of things, good and otherwise. This means that our thinking will be worldly, materialistic, and more or less disordered, because as we imagine, so we think. Therefore, to live in the psychical world is to live in a world of abnormal feeling and misdirected imagination. But true being cannot find its foundation in such a world. True being can be established only in the consciousness of truth, and the consciousness of truth can be gained only in the spirit. When life is established in the spiritual state, the physical ceases to be materialistic, and the psychical ceases to be a troubled sea of conflicting emotions. Instead, the physical becomes an orderly expression of the pure, wholesome life of the soul, and the psychical becomes a world of the richest thought, the most sublime feeling, and the highest mental enjoyment. The spiritual state of being is the true foundation of being, because the spiritual alone has the necessary qualities. To establish life in any other state or upon any other plane is to act contrary to the true order of things, and trouble must necessarily follow. There is only one place for man to live, and that is in the soul. When he tries to live elsewhere, in mind or body, he separates himself from his great inheritance and does not receive what he has the right and the privilege to receive. When there seems to be nothing in life, the fault lies with the man himself, not with the laws of his being. Instead of living in the spirit, where he could receive everything, he has gone to live in the emptiness of the material, where there is nothing to be had but the undesirable consequences of wrongdoing. And wrongdoing is the direct result of wrong going, going away from the true state of being. To live in the spiritual state is to give expression to everything that is in the spirit, because what we actually live, we bring out into tangible existence. And the spirit contains everything that may be required to perfect the whole of existence, physical, mental, and spiritual. The belief that the spiritual life is apart from the mental and physical is not true. It is the spiritual alone that can make the physical and the mental complete. In brief, we do not begin to enjoy the body and the mind until we begin to live in the soul. We cannot attain the most perfect physical health and the most perfect physical development until we can begin to draw upon the inexhaustible life of the spirit, nor can we attain the greatest intellectual power and the highest mental brilliancy until our minds are opened to real spiritual illumination. To have health and wholeness of body, we must have an abundance of that life that is health and wholeness, and that life comes only from the soul. To gain that life, we must live in the soul, and the life that we live, we invariably bring forth into mind and body. To perfect the beautiful in the physical form.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.